And if a tree petrifies standing up, and then later the dirt washes away from it, the petrified tree is going to fall over, and it's going to break up into logs. I don't know if you ever cut a tree down for firewood or not, but when you cut a tree down, it does not break up into logs for you automatically. You got to saw it up with your chainsaw. Well, yet if you look at the petrified forests in Calistoga, California, or Flora, Mississippi, or all over Arizona, or Central Texas, you find these petrified logs broken up as if it petrified standing and then fell over. I think the flood's the only way to explain that. Well, scuba divers went in under these log mats in Mount St. Helens in Spirit Lake, and they could see the logs are bouncing back and forth against each other, and it rolled all the bark off very quickly. All this bark settled to the bottom, made a thick layer of bark at the bottom, about 3 feet thick. That's going to turn to coal under the right conditions. Textbooks say it takes millions of years to coal to form. No, it doesn't either. Coal can be formed in a few hours in the laboratory. It doesn't take long. You get the right temperature, the right pressure, you can turn organic material into coal in a hurry. This picture shows a floating log mat model from Stephen Austin at ICR. I recommend his work tremendously. Incredibly well done stuff on the coal formation. He thinks during the flood, and I agree, there were huge log mats floating back and forth across the ocean. You'd get acres and acres of trees uprooted, floating back and forth, and as they float along, they drop off and leave a debris trail. As they float across, then pretty soon mud washes in, then they float back a few weeks later, and another layer of coal is going to form on top. The layers of coal that we see in the world are indication of a flood. Oftentimes, they dig down, hit a layer of coal, dig down some more, hit rock, and then dig down some more, hit more coal. I was just in West Virginia a couple weeks ago, and you can fly over West Virginia and see the coal mines that they have. Layer after layer of coal. They dig down, hit the coal, dig down a little more, hit dirt, and then more coal. Multiple layering is best explained by the flood. Now, I debated Jeannie Scott from Berserkly, California, and she said there are 80 separate layers of coal in the Midwest. She's right. She said, if you look at all the coal in the world, all the plants of the world today would not form that much fossil fuel. She's right. In other words, there's more coal in the ground now than there are trees to produce it. Here's a big chunk of coal from our museum. There is so much coal in the ground, if you took every bush and plant and tree and blade of grass in the world, you could not form all the coal that's found in the ground. She's right. There is an enormous amount of coal down there. Where'd it come from? She said, it took millions of years to form all this coal. No, Jeannie. It took a big flood, and you got to consider that the world before the flood was different. It was mostly covered with land and plants. The Bible says there were plants over the whole earth. Today, the earth is 70% underwater. Only 3% of the earth is habitable for mankind. So she's looking at the world today, assuming that's how it's always been. Now, the Bible warned us about those scoffers that would say, you know, the way things are happening today is the way they've always been, 2 Peter chapter 3. But she's wrong about it taking millions of years to form the coal. It took one big flood and a very different world to get flooded. The pre-flood world was a lot different. There's a coal mine in Montana, 10,000 square miles of coal up to 200 feet thick. Sometimes in the ceiling of the coal mines, they find dinosaur tracks. Hundreds of them. How do you explain this? Well, during the flood, you'd get log mats laid down and the dinosaurs are walking on top of it. And then later they drown. Another layer of mud washes in and fills in their footprints. And as they dig out the coal, they discover the footprints stuck in the ceiling. They were walking around in the debris trail left behind by this stuff. Here's a bunch of tracks. You can see the picture here. These are all footprints in the ceiling of coal mines. In central Alabama, there's a large coal mine. They find petrified trees standing up. A friend of mine works up there in the mine. He said oftentimes they find layers of coal that are separated, and pretty soon they come together. It's called lensing. Now, they're telling us that these coal layers are different ages. It's just simply not true. The coal layers and the mud layers all form simultaneously, just like with this thing. You can flip it around back and forth, and you can see little lenses form in here. Sometimes they are layers of rock, layers of dark in between layers of white, and the white comes together. Formations in Wyoming, oftentimes the textbooks say it took millions of years to form the Green River Formation. When they dig down through the Green River Formation, they find different numbers of layers between different areas. We cover all that in video number 7. It did not take a long time to form that. It took a big flood. Now, sometimes in coal, human artifacts are found, like this bell found inside a lump of coal in West Virginia, or this zinc and silver vessel found in solid rock in Massachusetts. Textbook says this is, you know, 600 million year old rock. No, it's not. In 1891, they found a gold chain inside a lump of coal back in Illinois. A carved stone was found inside a lump of coal in Iowa. Here's an iron pot. There's a model of it right here on the table. This is a casting of the iron pot found inside a lump of coal in Oklahoma. The real one's in Carl Baugh's museum in Glen Rose, Texas. The sole of a shoe was found inside a lump of coal. There's an article about it right here. And they said the rock was 213 million years old. Now, coal formed during that flood in the days of Noah. The Bible says in Genesis 8, the waters assuaged. They dropped down. They sank down. And then it says the water was going and returning. It returned from off the earth continually. The Hebrew phrase here in Genesis 8 is going and returning. Halak vashab. The water was going and returning. Well, if you get sections of the earth that sink down, the water's going to rush in and then slosh back and forth, probably for weeks, as the energy gets dissipated. This is the best way to explain the horizontal bedding planes that we see, the mud layers settling out flat, and then folding up as the mountains arose and the valleys sank down, and then getting washed off by subsequent erosion, and then new layers being put on top. These places are called unconformities in geology. The bottom of Grand Canyon has a huge one. I think the flood's the best explanation for all this, not millions of years of slow, gradual accumulation. The Bible says the ark rested in the seventh month. Now, Noah didn't get out till the 13th month. If you read through Genesis, you'll see God told him to go in the ark, told him when to go out of the ark. He was in there for over 12 and a half months. But it rested in the seventh month. Why would he stay in there the extra 5 and a half months after the ark hit bottom? If Noah's ark is indeed 17 miles from the main Mount Ararat, then we have a piece of it. This is a piece of the formation that Ron Wyatt thinks is Noah's ark. So that might be a piece of the ark, I don't know. But why would he stay in there for all that extra time? Why not get out? Well, for one reason, the ark water was still going back and forth. It wasn't safe to get out yet. Maybe that's why some of the anchor stones are found several miles from where the ark is. They might have cut the ropes loose, and then another wave comes back, lifts them up, and moves them inland a few miles, sets them down again. So there may be a reason for the separation there. Plus, the ground is still muddy outside, and there's nothing to eat outside and nothing to build with. It would take a while for things to grow again. Seeds that floated around in the flood would tend to regerminate and start to grow afterwards, and you end up 5 months later, now it's time to get out. There's stuff to eat outside. The Bible says in the 10th month, the tops of the mountains were seen. So here's the Hovind theory. Over the next few years, 100 years actually, the ice cap slowly melted back. This makes the oceans larger, the continents smaller. It gives us a continental shape.